Good morning. Welcome to Green Lake Seventh-day Adventist Church. We're delighted that you can join us. We wish we could be together in person, but here we are connecting through the means of electronics. And we're really delighted that you can be here. To begin our service, we have a prelude by our Minister of Music, Wanda Griffiths. And we will turn to that. Again, welcome to Green Lake Church. We're so delighted that you can join us via the means of electronics and the internet. Welcome. We're glad that you're here. We have several announcements to share with you today. Maybe we should begin with birthdays. I completely forgot that last week. So I have several birthdays to share with you today from last week and this coming week. Rachel Fio, happy birthday. You've got a new baby in your family. I've been watching you on Facebook. Happy birthday to Rachel. And Ethan Carley, happy birthday to you. Let's see. And then one of our grown-up young people. You're still young, Andrew. Andrew Gaju, happy birthday to you. We're so delighted that you're part of our family. Ann White, happy birthday. And all the very best to you. And Wes Lauer, happy birthday to you. Those are the ones I had on my list. If I missed somebody, you be sure and let me know. But happy birthday to those of you who are having birthdays last week and this coming week. We pray that God will give you a rich blessing here as you enter the next year of your life. Sabbath school classes. I know that Sabbath school classes are going on. I stuck my head in, metaphorically, for a few minutes into the library class this morning. I know the fireside class is meeting through the Bible class. We have the children's class led by Elise. We have the youth class led by Mindy Jones and Lisi and Kian and Brenda Kapush. Thank you for your work in those classes. If you would like to be, and then the women's class led by Patty Gibson. So if you'd like to be part of one of our classes, let us know. We'll get you in touch with the host so that they can give you the login information. It's a wonderful way to participate in meaningful discussion and conversation, have a sense of connection with one another, and to have a sense of belonging here while we're so separated physically. We had a really happy thing happen in the church building yesterday. I was here in the afternoon and went down to the sanctuary, and there were people in the sanctuary. Not very many, but there were real live people. Shelley Legrone had organized a practice for a bell duet by Megan Rickaby and Lisa Kim Barton. And it was wonderful to see real live human beings in there. They were wearing masks, so I could hardly see them, and they were properly distancing themselves. But they were in the sanctuary making music, and Liz Rickaby was there as an appreciative audience. So it was nice to see that yesterday, and I'm sure that someday soon here on Zoom, we will get to hear that. Let's see what other announcements do we have. I think that's pretty much it for our announcements. Here in Seattle, of course, there are ongoing protests, people clamoring for justice. And part of the Christian tradition going back to the very beginning is a lively sense of God's regard for the lowly. Throughout Scripture, God is said to be on the side of the widow, the orphan, the fatherless, the foreigner, the poor. God cares about the lowly, the vulnerable, and he expects us to stand for them. So I want to thank you, Green Lake folks who've been in the streets, and who those of you who have found other ways to be supportive of this cry for justice. We pray that the protests will remain peaceful and that they will be effective in bringing about change and moving us ever closer to our ideals, which we as a nation espouse, liberty and justice for all. That's our prayer. So now it's time for our morning hymn. So let's see. Our hymn this morning is Come Thou Almighty King, hymn number 71 in the Adventist hymnal. So then we'll have our morning hymn.
Thank you.
Let's pray together. Creator of earth and sky and sea, maker of every nation, every tribe, every people, thank you for calling us together this morning and receiving us with your smile. Lord of the nations, we pray that you will hasten the day when spears are turned into pruning hooks, swords are turned into plowshares, and justice rolls down like the great river. Lord, we pray for the day when the wealth of the nations is used for the blessing of all people, and the power of the nations is used to uplift the lowly. We pray, Lord, that you will work in our own hearts. You have formed us and shaped us in your image, and now we pray that you will renew that image in us and make us agents of your kingdom. Empower us in the week to come to act as agents of righteousness. Help us to accomplish justice and peace is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Green Lake Church is part of the Global Seventh-day Adventist Church. One of the departments of the Adventist Church in Canada and the United States is multilingual ministries. This department celebrates the beauty of all the languages we speak and strives to meet the spiritual and social needs of those whose primary language is Arabic, Korean, Russian, Spanish, and many others. When you give today, you can dedicate your offering to this ministry by placing it in the World Budget line of the online giving page of the church's website. Of course, you can also give to the local church budget on that same page. Will you bow your heads with me? Heavenly Father, you have given us so many ways to express ourselves. We thank you for the gift of language and for those who have mastered several languages so that we can learn from one another and share the message of Christ and his love. Bless this offering that it may go far in supporting our multilingual communities. En el nombre de Jesús, amen.
I want to tell you a story today about a time that I got lost in the woods and what happened to me. When I was growing up, we lived in front of a pretty big forest. Our house just was right up against it. And it was really fun to go out there and explore. And there were all these trails and everything that I could go on. We found actually some old cars out there at one point that were just totally overgrown with blackberries and everything. And there's just so much to see and explore. And it was really great. So one day, my friend and I decided that we were going to take a longer hike through the woods. And so we packed backpacks and we made all these kinds of preparations, but we didn't bring the things that we really needed. We didn't pack any water. We didn't pack any food. We brought toys. We brought fun things. Sunglasses and hats was probably the most useful thing that we actually brought with us. And so we went out and we went pretty deep into the woods and we were out for quite a while. And wouldn't you know, pretty soon we got turned around and we didn't know where we were. And we walked and walked and we tried to look for something familiar, but just nothing looked right. And we didn't know where we were. And it was pretty clear that we were lost. And we thought, oh no, what are we going to do? How are we going to get home? And after a long time, my friend went into his backpack and he pulled out this thing that he hadn't told me about. And he said, I think I have some food for us. And the food was a pack of gum that he had brought. And he thought, you know, this is something that we can eat because we really don't have anything else. And I knew that we might be in trouble. So we kind of didn't really know what to do. And we sat down and tried to make a plan. And then all of a sudden, this dog came out of nowhere and wanted to play with us. And we thought that maybe the dog could help us find the way home. And so we kind of talked to the dog and told the dog what we needed. And after a little while, the dog took off and we followed the dog. And I think we took sort of a winding path, but eventually we did get home. And I couldn't tell you if the dog helped us or not. Probably not. It was probably just a coincidence, but it was a pretty interesting experience. And that day I learned that sometimes hope can come from unexpected places and help can come from unexpected places. And it was great to have my friend with me and to try to solve the problem together. And in the end, whether it was the dog or not, we were able to solve the problem and make it home. So probably should have packed a little differently, but that's another story. Thanks for listening, you guys. Take care.
Please bow your heads with me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we are thankful for the community you have provided us within this church. And we are especially thankful for the talents and skills of those who are keeping us connected while we physically remain apart. We know that in the big scheme of things, this time is just a flicker, but it feels like we've been apart so very long, and time feels precious. Lord, thank you for giving us patience. Father, all the generations of this nation are grieving for lost time, but also for lost lives. We grieve for the Black lives that have been lost disproportionately through this pandemic, yet we are slow to recognize how the world we built would produce these results. We grieve for the much longer history of named and unnamed Black lives that have been and continue to be lost to pointless violence. And we have to ask ourselves why we've been unable in our lifetimes to make it stop. Our children are looking at the world and wonder why on earth we would allow it to work this way. Truthful answers are ugly and hard to explain. We also know that you sent your son, knowing that he would be hated and die a violent death. You sent him not only to give us the most precious gift of life, but to show us a better way. Lord, please make your way our way. Thank you for the love that you've put into this community. Help us to have clear eyes, strong backs, and soft hearts. For in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
The Old Testament scripture reading is 1 Chronicles chapter 29, verses 10 through 13. David praised the Lord in the presence of the whole assembly. O Lord, the God of our ancestor Israel, may you be praised forever and ever. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the victory, and the majesty. Everything in the heavens and on earth is yours, O Lord, and this is your kingdom. We adore you as the one who is over all things. Wealth and honor come from you alone, for you rule over everything. Power and might are in your hand, and at your discretion, people are made great and given strength. O our God, we thank you and praise your glorious name.
The New Testament reading is Luke 10, verse 25 to 28. One day, an expert in religious law stood up to test Jesus by asking him this question: "Teacher, what should I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus replied, "What does the law of Moses say? How do you read it?" The man answered, "You must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your strength, and all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself." "Right," Jesus told him, "do this and you will live."
I'm so delighted that you are with us. And it's so fun to see the kids on the screen. I would love to see them in person, but it is sure fun to see them on the screen. Let me just mention to you our special music. Our last special music there was presented by Sophie Naden Johns. She was accompanied by Susanna Valu on the piano. She was playing Sonata for Cello and Piano, Opus 65, Largo by Frédéric Chopin. Chopin, something like that. You know that guy that when I was a kid, I called him Chopin, but it's Chopin. It's been a wild week, a wild 2 weeks, a wild 3 or 4 months. And we come together repeatedly on Sabbath to renew our faith that above all the confusion, there is a loving God who is active, and to renew our sense of direction from the words of Scripture. And so we do that again today. We're going to look to the Bible and see if we can draw from there some lessons for our thinking, for our heart, and for our policy and our policy making as we look in Scripture. The book of Judges describes a time when the nation of Israel was like the Wild West before the law arrived. After white folks had defeated the Indians, but before we had established any kind of regular system of law. Everybody, you know, basically it was the guy with the biggest gun who could do whatever he wanted. And that's the way it was in Israel. They had complete freedom. The book of Judges makes the point that that freedom was not so good. Its phrase was, it says, everyone did what was right in his own eyes. There was no king. And it makes that statement in connection with stories of really horrific crimes and brutality. The nation needed some order. It needed somebody to be in charge. And so they decided they wanted a king like the other nations had. The prophet Samuel tried to warn them, said, "Wait a minute, you guys, do you realize how much a king is going to cost you? Do you realize what's going to happen when somebody becomes in charge? They're going to take care of things you want taken care of, and they're going to take care of a bunch of other stuff too." But the people said, no, we need a king. We need a policeman. We need somebody to keep things in order. And so Saul, at the direction of God, the prophet Samuel, at the direction of God, anointed Saul to be king over Israel. And it started off really great. Saul very early on showed a magnanimous spirit. He managed dissent in the kingdom in a way that pacified people and prevented bloodshed and internal conflict. He brought the nation together. And then he led the nation and their armies to victories over the Philistine armies. Things were going really well. But later in his reign, he kind of got off track. And finally, God announced that when Saul died, his son Jonathan would not take the throne, but in fact, it was going to be another person, a kid named David. Saul, this is every king, dreams that his son is going to take his place and maintain the dynasty. Saul made it his business to kill David. He invested the entire energy of the nation and the nation's army to get rid of this threat to his power. He spent several years chasing David with the army, trying to kill him. As we're reading the story, we understand that Saul had the legal authority to have David executed. Saul was king, and the king's word is law. And if the king said David had to go, well, then David had to go. But you and I reading the story, clearly know, you know, we feel in our gut that the king is wrong. He may have the legal authority. He may have the power to kill David. But we know that he does not have the moral authority. And that if he uses his power to kill David, it will be illegitimate. Twice during this time, King Saul inadvertently puts himself in a place where David could take out King Saul. And David's men are urging him, look, God put your enemy in your hands. Kill him. He's trying to kill you, so you kill him. David had the power to kill Saul, but David refused. He said, I do not have the authority. Yes, I could do it. But I won't. He limited his power. And we have respected him for 3,000 years since then, in part because of that restraint, that self-restraint he practiced on his power. Another time, somebody gravely insulted David before David was king. And David got mad. David called his men together and said, come on, let's go get that guy. We're going to kill every male in his household. He has insulted us. We've been kind to him. Now he blows us off and treats us rudely. We'll get him. So David and his men set off to kill off the household of Nabal. But on the way, they were met by Nabal's wife named Abigail. She encountered David because she had heard he was coming. And she said, David, let me see if I can talk to you. She talked him out of killing her husband, and her argument went like this. You are going to be king one day. And when you become king, you don't want to have your record besmirched with the history of avenging yourself for a petty insult. You want to be greater than that. Don't use your power to kill the man who has insulted you. Use your judgment to rise above it. David listened to her. He did not kill Nabal. And we have honored both David and Abigail, again, for 3,000 years. I wish we could stop there with David's story, but it doesn't stop there. After he became king early on, he demonstrated great magnanimity. Again, we honor David for that. We talk about him as a man after God's own heart. He was chosen by God to be king. He was a good king. And then he got old. And while his army was out at battle, he looked over and he saw a woman named Bathsheba taking a bath on the roof of her house. He sent men to summon her to the palace where he seduced or raped her, depending on how you tell the story. And then when she became pregnant, he had her husband murdered. That's important to understand. He had the legal authority to do these things. He was a king. Kings were absolute monarchs. Their word was law. If David decided you belong to him, he had the legal authority to take you. And if David decided that you should die, he had the legal authority, the legal power anyway, to make you die. And so Uriah was killed at the king's orders. But it was wrong. And the prophet Nathan came in to see David and told David a story. He said, David, there was these two guys. One was poor. The only thing he owned was one sheep. The sheep was in the telling of the story, the sheep was for that man like our dogs are for us. You know, it's part of the family. He loved the sheep. The neighbor was a rich man. A traveler came, and the rich man had his men go and grab the poor man's sheep. And they slaughtered the sheep so they could have a feast for the traveler. As Nathan the prophet is telling this story to David, David is getting outraged. How could somebody do such a thing? That's awful. The man deserves to die, but at least he'll have to pay back four times what he took. And the prophet said to David, "You are the man. What you have done is a monstrous evil, and you're going to pay." It's important to understand that the role of prophets throughout the Old Testament was to confront the kings. Occasionally they commended the kings, yes. But the prophets were the voice of conscience to say to the king, just because you have the power, you do not have the right. Power and authority, just authority, are not the same thing. There are many things you can do that you must not do. And it remains one of the functions of the church to keep that voice of conscience alive. We do not get confused about power and authority. Just because somebody has the power to do something does not mean they have the authority to do it. Just because they have the legal authority to do it does not mean they have the moral authority to do it. We as a church teach our young people to keep a clear moral vision and not be seduced by symbols of power, by the persuasiveness of position, by tradition, by heritage. We teach our young people to keep their moral vision clear. And we need to support them when they exercise that moral vision and remind us what we have taught them, when they call us to live out what we have taught them. Very well. You know, we, as a society right now, we're remembering, I will name the three names, Ahmaud Arbery, Breonna Taylor, and George Floyd. And I think of the case of Ahmaud Arbery. He was running and he was accosted by two men. And we go, wait a minute, they have no authority to do that. What right do these men have to accost somebody who's running through the neighborhood? They had no authority to accost him, no authority to question him, no authority to detain him. We can see clearly the evil of what they did because they had no authority, even though they had lots of power because they had guns in their hands. We have the case of Breonna Taylor, who was killed in her own bed by police who were breaking down the door to their house. And in this case, the police had full legal authority to do what they did. Now, they were at the wrong house. But even if they had been at the right house, their actions could have easily resulted in people being killed. And the behavior, breaking into a house unannounced, was legal. And so their city has now changed the law because the law itself was immoral. It was wrong. There was legal authority for that police action, but it was immoral. It was a monstrous evil. The law has been changed, which does not bring back Ms. Taylor. And then we have the case of George Floyd, who committed a minor infraction, and we're not excusing that, but he did something wrong. He was arrested by police who had the authority to arrest him. And then he was killed by an officer who did not have that authority. He had the power. If this had been some other man, a man without a uniform, kneeling on George's neck, the bystanders would have saved him. But they could not save him because the man kneeling on Mr. Floyd's neck wore the uniform. He represented us, civil society. And even though he had the uniform, what he did was a damnable evil. We need to be clear on that. He had the power. He used his power. And it was wrong. Yesterday, I walked around in the Capitol Hill Autonomous Zone, as they call it, a few blocks here in Seattle that some activists and protesters have set up as a place where they don't want police in there. And as I listened to speeches yesterday there, I did not hear what sounded to me like a workable program for reordering our city in a way that would lead to liberty and justice for all. But what I did hear was youthful hope and aspiration for a better city, a better society, a better world. A youthful understanding that established power is not necessarily legitimate power, that there are laws of justice that stand above the laws of the city, of the state, of the nation. I heard young people affirming what we teach in our Sabbath school. Sometimes you have to obey God rather than man. When the laws of men contradict the laws of God, we don't have a choice. We have to obey God, even if that means defying human authority. Down in Arizona, there's a law against helping people crossing the border illegally. Scott Walker was arrested because he had given life-saving aid to a couple of people who were coming across the desert. He clearly broke the law because he believed it was more moral to save a life than it was to obey the law. Obedience is not the highest value, not in the church, and not for Scott Walker, fortunately. So he was arrested. He was tried, and glory hallelujah, twice the jury refused to convict him because they said, doesn't matter what the law says, when it comes to saving life, that is the highest value. Of course we need laws. We need order. We need police to help keep order. But there is a higher value than any civil statute, and that is the value of saving life. Recently, we had the picture of the president waving the Bible like a flag. And the Bible is the flag of our religion. It is one of the most potent symbols of our faith as a community. And it is appropriate for us to ask then, what does that flag stand for? And if you open the book, it's a long book. It's 1,000 pages. There are lots of details in there, lots of little laws and regulations in the Old Testament, especially in the books of Moses. Laws about what kind of clothes you can wear. Laws about tattoos. Laws about menstruation. I mean, there's laws. There's all kinds of laws in there. And we can get lost in all those little details. But fortunately, there are a couple of places in the Bible where the authors say, look, let's summarize things for you. Let's be clear what is most important. And we already know what that is. We have the famous passage in Micah 6:8. He has shown you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you? But to do justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with our God. This is our religion. I just had somebody yesterday asking me what I thought about some bizarre theory of vaccines and chips and the mark of the beast. And I smiled and I said, I don't even think about it anymore. I said, because my religion is defined by Micah 6:8. And if that's not enough for you, if you don't understand the call for justice, the call to do mercy, the call to walk humbly with God, well, then let's go to Jesus, where Jesus summarizes the entire Old Testament and by implication, the New Testament as well, although it had not yet been written. What is the great law? Love God with your whole being. What comes after that? So how do we do that? We love our neighbors as ourselves. This is who we are. And just as in every family, we give the most care to the children who need it most, So in our society, we give the most care to our citizens who need it the most. We don't give aid to those who already are doing quite well, thank you. If we are Christians, we seek to shape our society so that the strength and wealth and power of our society is focused especially on helping those who need help the most. So when we say Black Lives Matter, we're not denying that all lives matter, but we are saying there are some members in our community who have been specially disadvantaged, and it's time for us to give special aid. And once we recognize that Black Lives Matter and that our Black citizens need some special attention because they have been specially disadvantaged, when we embrace that, we will then turn and notice others also who need special assistance because they have been specially disadvantaged, our Native American citizens, people with disabilities. We will understand that that which makes us strong, whether it's our keen intellect, whether it is our education, whether it's our good luck, our good health, whether it's our American passport, whatever it is that makes us strong and capable, is a summons by God to serve. And we, as the community of Jesus, we will do it. We will love justice. We will do mercy, and we will walk humbly with our God. May God help us. And now it's time for our closing. Let's pray together. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. And may the Lord work through you peace for all in your realm. Amen. Thank you for being with us here at Green Lake Church today. The Lord bless you as you go out this week. Do justice, to love mercy, to walk humbly with your God. And then I hope you'll join us again next week for worship. And now, to close our service, Wanda Griffiths, our Minister of Music, has a postlude.
I fall on my knees. your grace still amazes me. Your grace still amazes me. It's deeper, it's wider.